You will never run away, you're by my side.
Trouble anywhere. take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus, He knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in
sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who've strayed. come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay
make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell is empty dreams. I got lost in the lie that it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. But Jesus is the only name to remember. And I don't wanna leave a legacy. I don't care if they remember me. Only Jesus. And I've only got we'll
Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, with me in the calm, with me in the storm, sovereign in my greatest joy, sovereign in my deepest cry, with me in the dark.
Good morning, everyone. Great to have you with us this morning. If you're joining us online this morning, thank you so much for typing in that URL and joining us and preparing your heart to make much of Jesus today. It's what we strive to do each and every day, but in particular when we gather as the body of Christ. We love doing this, and we are just so thrilled that you have made it a part of your routine, part of your life, and that you've made it a part of your day and your morning today. Kari is going to be speaking today. We're looking forward to hearing, Kari, what the Lord has laid on your heart. And my wife, Heather, and I, and our team, Adam, Aline, and Krista are going to lead you and guide you and join you as we lift Jesus high and we sing of his incredible love for us. Would you stand with us? Here's our call to worship. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we are your church, and we come into your presence. We welcome one another, and we welcome you. In ways that we could only hope or imagine, make yourself known to us through our worship today, through our prayers, and through your word. Increase in us, Lord God, with our hands lifted high, in the name and power of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
like a rushing wind. Come like the fire again. Come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. Come like a rushing wind. Come like the fire again. Come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. With our hands to the heavens alive, in your presence, oh God, when you come.
Heavenly Father, would you come and fill us? Lord, we're broken, we're imperfect. We have got cracks. Lord, there are places that Lord leak, there are holes. We try to put things into us and inside of us to fill us and complete us. And Lord, they're like sifting sand. They just fall through our fingers. But Lord, we know that you are the one who created us, and you are the one who completes us. And Father, we long to experience that abundant life that Jesus said is ours if we only ask. So Father, would you come? Come and lead us and guide us. And Father, it's quite a thing that the Apostle Peter, when he refers to the church, he refers to it as the people who are holy, the holy ones. And Father, we feel far from holy. We know, Lord, that we have this idea that somehow that's supposed to mean that we're perfect, but it's not. It truly means that you long to set us apart, and that you long to do with us the things that we were always created and prepared to do and to be. And Father, you want us to be like your Son. You want us to follow him and to learn to live the way that he taught us to live. And you want us, Lord, to leave all that other stuff behind. Father, our illness, our infirmities today, you want us to leave those behind. Father, our turmoil, our challenges, our problems, you want us to leave those behind. Father, might we leave those at the cross? And might we just truly experience, Lord, in this time, in this place, online today, Lord, as a community of faith, might we experience your fullness, that we might be able to cry out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Lord, we long to experience your presence. Lord, be with us, fill us, and lead us. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Our song shall rise to thee. Holy. and I will live my life for Him. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea.
Fill us. Holy Spirit, reveal to us the truth of who we are. Lord, wholly fill us that we might know who we are in Jesus Christ and in Him crucified, in Him buried, in Him raised to life again. Lord, might we experience the newness of life to be able to overcome the darkness. Lord, whatever it might be today, Lord, whatever word, whatever picture, whatever thought, whatever scripture comes into our mind, even now, Lord, fill us to overflowing that we might experience the fullness of life through the Spirit of Christ who is alive and with us.
Fill me now, fill me now, Spirit.
You may be seated.
pull this up a little bit. Well, it's good for us to acknowledge and publicly give thanks to our Heavenly Father. So, before we pray, I'm going to share with you a short testimony. Last weekend, we were in Toronto visiting family, checking up on them, and normally we would head home after supper. But that Sunday, we just got the urge, pack up and leave after lunch. So we did, and had a good ride home. And when we got home, we watched the news, and we heard that there had been a sizable tornado that tore along Highway 7, same route that we had driven 2 hours earlier. I guess some would say that we were lucky, but I'd say, according to Psalm 84, the Lord is my light and my protector. He was directing our timing and protecting our travel. And we're grateful. You can believe that. So let's pray together. I know that many of you will have similar exciting stories that happened with you this week. And it's good for us to share them together. It's encouraging. Okay, let's pray. Mighty and gracious God, we come to you because you have invited us. Thank you for your graciousness today and in times past. When we pause to remember how you have led us and kept us and blessed us, we can't help but be in awe of your power and your holiness. Forgive us, our God, for the times and the ways that we've hurt others, and in those ways we've grieved you. We're sorry. We're truly sorry about that. Thank you for your forgiveness. You have shown us also your compassion and your comfort when we are in need. We ask for healing and strength for sick bodies and for those who are caregivers. Will you give energy and encouragement? We ask for your care over those struggling with broken relationships. And God, we ask that you give peace to those with troubled hearts or those who are waiting for surgery or family members who are waiting for loved ones who will be leaving soon. We pray for the ones in terrible situations because of climate conditions, because of persecution conditions, because of war. Lord, show that you are light and protection for your world full of needs. May those who love you speak up about who you are and what you have done for us, what you can do for them. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus, whose sacrifice on the cross is our salvation. His life is our example. May we leave here desiring to be like him and to serve him with our hearts. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen.
I invite you to stand once more as you are able.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name, Jesus.
my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. I raise a hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, we raise a hallelujah today. Lord, some of us are battling health concerns that some of us can't even fathom or contemplate coming into our lives. Lord, for those individuals, we raise a hallelujah. Lord, somebody today has lost work and employment and they're wondering what they're going to do with their family. Lord, I can't imagine being in that situation. Lord, for those who are there, we raise a hallelujah. Lord, whatever is going on, a mountaintop experience or a valley below, where we know you are with us. You are with us every step of the way. And Lord, we praise you and we say hallelujah. You are with us. Lord, to be with you is the safest place we could possibly ever be. Lord, may we draw closer and closer and closer to you today, the one who sticks closer than a sibling. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, before Kari comes up, I'm going to read the scripture, and it literally is the scripture. It's great. Let us come before the Lord, and let us read His Word. Reading Matthew chapter 13. If you have brought a device or you've brought a good old-fashioned paper Bible, I've got lots of those. But if you have it, you can follow along. We're reading in the New King James Version, and we're reading Matthew chapter 13, verse 33, and it is the parable of the leaven. And we read verse 33, "Another parable he," that's Jesus, "another parable he spoke to them, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till it was all leavened." And the Lord will bless the reading of His Word. Heavenly Father, be with Kari as he comes and he speaks and he shares with us your holy word. Father, give him power from on high and give him gentleness, Lord, as he comes and he shares in grace and truth and love the truth of who you are. And Lord, we will be the better for it, we know. And we pray, thanking you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Wow. Good morning to each one of you. It's a pleasure to be with you on this midsummer morning. Nice and cool this morning. Supposed to be warmer later. And welcome to all of you out there in TV land. If you're not getting very good reception, just get some tin foil, put it on the aerial, and you'll be just fine. Now, it seems that often I share in the summer, kind of midsummer time like this, and often Marquita's away visiting family out west, and that is the case today. So good morning, Marquita, over the interweb here. Now, last week, Pastor Bob was talking about flourishing, wasn't he? And we had lots of scientific formulas, and scientists had done all this research on flourishing, on human flourishing, and there seemed to be one big piece left out in all the scientific studies. Anybody pick up on that? It was God. God was kind of left out. Now, of course, the Christians who had done this study had kind of factored God in. Thank you, Lord, for that. But it became clear that we who follow Christ should have a different view of flourishing than what the rest of the world has. Do you think that's true? I certainly think so. And, you know, as we continue to talk about this flourishing, I'm going to go back to some simple parables that you've heard many times before. And this preaching on the kingdom that Jesus did, I think sometimes we can overlook. We can kind of gloss over it a little bit. Now, to kick us off today, I'm going to be speaking to you about one of my favorite subjects, baking. Now, while I am not an expert baker, I am an expert in evaluating and ingesting the products of an expert baker. You could call me an expert baking eater. pastries, cookies, you name it, I am an expert on all of those things, and I have a bit of a sweet tooth. Now, when I was a kid, my mother did all kinds of baking, cakes, pies, cookies, all kinds of stuff, but there was one thing she baked that was the pièce de résistance. It is called pulla. Pulla. It's a Finnish coffee bun made with cardamom and a light egg and sugar glaze. And all throughout my childhood, there may be a picture of it up there, I watched my mother making this pulla. She would mix the dough, then add the essential ingredient, yeast. She would knead in the yeast, work it through, cover the lump, place it in a warm place, and guess what happened? It rose. Absolutely, it rose. Then she'd take three long tubes and braid them together and put them in the oven, and out would come fresh, light, risen, warm pulla. And I was the first one next to the oven when it came out of there. And I put some butter on there and eat it. And it was delicious. But there was times when the yeast didn't work, or the dough was too cool, or my mom was in a rush and didn't knead it in properly, and guess what happened? Flop. A flop. It was not eaten, it was actually thrown out. Even the dog wouldn't eat it. It was such a flop. But thankfully in my childhood, there was very few flops. Very few. See, flops are such a disappointment because you spend so much time and energy and then the cost of all the ingredients, and we just can't take a flop. But how about you? If you were a loaf of bread, would you feel like a flop this morning? Someone who hasn't risen to the occasion? Have you really blown it? How about being treated like you were a person of no value at all? Could it be that someone has told you that you were a failure? Or maybe there is just this nagging feeling like you aren't cutting it as a Christian. You're a second-class Christian. Well-known pastor John Piper was interviewing a Christian counselor on his program recently, and he was talking about this very issue. They were speaking about feelings of self-disappointment, self-condemnation, and then they started to use a very strong word, self-hate. Wow, that's a strong word, self-hate. Like when we look around at others and compare ourselves to others, and we don't seem to measure up, we can hate ourselves for how we look, how we feel, what we've done, what's been done to us, or what we keep failing to accomplish. This self-hatred often lives under the surface of our lives because it has never been named and identified. So, John Piper gave it a name, self-hatred. And this self-hatred, he says, can fuel self-condemnation and feed all sorts of false attempts at self-atonement, like works righteousness. This is not the flourishing that we're talking about, is it? This self-hatred can just drive us into doing things that God never designed for us to do. And as John Piper and this counselor spoke, they spoke about two books. The first was a book written for Christians who struggle with this kind of self-condemnation and self-hate by Ed Welsh. It's called Shame Interrupted. It's proven helpful for many. The second was written by the counselor Dave Powlison himself, entitled Good and Angry, Redeeming Anger, Irritation, Complaining, and Bitterness. That's quite a title, isn't it? Powlison's book addresses self-hate, and specifically for those who feel self-hate for something they have brought on to themselves, some personal sin or personal failure. What is clear from Piper and the counselor is that many Christians struggle with self-disappointment and self-condemnation, maybe even self-hate, as tragic as that is. For any of you who have struggled with these feelings, I have hope for you today. Hope for you who feel like a flop, maybe even hope for what we can call kingdom flourishing. Now, our big idea this morning is that kingdom flourishing comes when we work out what God has worked in. Now, you'll recognize the second part of this verse from Philippians 2, which tells us that we are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in us to will and to act according to his purpose. So there's a working in and a working out, and we're going to be talking about that in flourishing. So this kingdom flourishing comes when we work out what God has worked in. And Stephen, thank you for reading the scripture this morning. I appreciate it. You know, you look at this parable, he, Jesus speaking, spoke to them. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven or like yeast, which a woman took and hid, kneaded in to 3 measures of meal till it was all leavened. This is the word of the Lord. Now, when we come to Matthew 13, you got to have some background. It's a whole chapter, and the whole chapter is 7 different parables. That's what the whole chapter is. Jesus speaks about the kingdom of heaven. And there's 2 things we have to understand before we really get into this scripture. The first is kingdom, and the second, a parable. So let's start with kingdom. Every kingdom must have 4 basic elements to be called a kingdom. It has to have a regent. It has to have residents, rules, and a realm. And the kingdom of heaven contains all of these. We have a regent, who is Jesus, the Son of David, the Son of God. We have residents or subjects, who are those who come to God through Jesus Christ. That would be us, wouldn't it? We have a rule, a way of living, which is love the Lord and love your neighbor as yourself, isn't it? Isn't that our rule of life? And then we have a realm. And this is everywhere that the king exerts his influence, including where his people are, where the Holy Spirit is working. His realm is much greater than the church, but it includes his church, doesn't it? But then, that would just be a regular kingdom. But we have something special, don't we? We have a secret sauce, which I'm going to be talking about a little bit later. Who is that person that is the secret sauce? The Holy Spirit. It is a representative, a 5th R. We have an ambassador that comes to live within our hearts, and I'm going to be talking about that as we go on. But you have to understand, this isn't like a normal kingdom. It's special. And history, then, is the story of the formation and development of the kingdom of heaven from a seed to a mighty tree that covers the whole earth. And so Jesus, in these 7 parables, is teaching about how this kingdom of heaven works. Now, the parables. The definition of a parable from Merriam-Webster is a usually short, fictitious story that illustrates a moral attitude or a religious principle. And so according to this definition, the point of a parable is to take something unclear or unpersuasive and make them clear and persuasive towards a moral or religious point. And so the power of a parable is that it's a short story, and these stories have power to sneak up on you and get through some ideological and mental defenses to get to your heart. It goes through, goes past your brain right to your heart so you can react to it. Now, probably the best example in scripture, I think, is David and Nathan. King David and Nathan. Do you remember that? 2 Samuel 12, some of you will remember that. David had committed adultery with Bathsheba and sent her husband off to be killed. Nathan the prophet comes and starts talking to him, tells him this story of a rich man entertaining a friend who took another poor man's lamb from him and prepared that lamb for a guest. And David gets all indignant, says he burns with anger against the man, and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, what? "You are the man." "You the man, David. You the man." You see, David didn't realize what was going on. He got all fired up and burned with anger and then realized, "I am the one who has done this." You see how the parable snuck past David's defenses and got to his heart. This is why I think Jesus so often taught in parables. He would discern where the Spirit of the Lord was working in the lives of those who heard. Yet many were offended by Jesus' parables. They didn't even try to understand them. And so he speaks of this kingdom has many things, like many facets of a diamond. You have to look at it from different angles to really appreciate it. And that's what he was doing. And so the 7 parables he talks about in this chapter are the parable of the sower, of the tares, of the mustard seed, of the leaven, of the hidden treasure, the pearl of great price, and the dragnet. And our parable of the leaven comes right in the middle, or fourth in the list. Now you got to remember, this is just a little parable, one verse, but from it, you'll see that things are coming, that this kingdom flourishing comes when we work out what God works in. Now here's the problem. We've got misconceptions, and so did the people of that time. And the first kingdom, the first misconception is that kingdom flourishing is all external, outside of us, outside of us. But what does the parable say? The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid or kneaded in. It was going in, wasn't it? Till it was all leavened. Have you ever wondered why Jesus had to use this many parables? There's several others in other chapters of the Bible. It's because the disciples, let alone the Jewish people of that time, had major misconceptions about the kingdom. And the first misconception is the disciples thought, like other devout Jews, that the Messiah would be a conquering king. He'd arrive in Judea with great pomp and celebration. The son of David would sit on David's physical throne. Maybe with armies of angels, the son of David would destroy the hated Roman occupiers and make Israel a world military and economic power. A physical Davidic kingdom with physical, tangible outcomes. What was all this talk about paths, seeds, nets, wheats, tares, pearls? They weren't understanding it. They weren't getting it. Major misconception. The second misconception is the Jews thought that when God's kingdom came, it would be visible. There'd be like this glorious aura, like a magic rainbow that would come over the ancient Near East or something. It would be great and it would be glorious. But what did Jesus say in Luke 17 when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come? Jesus answered them, "The kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they see, look here, or look there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is what? It's within you, isn't it? The kingdom of God is within you." These guys are going, "Within you? What do you mean? It's like Jonah in the belly of a fish or something? What is he talking about?" It just didn't seem right to many of them at the time. Now, the third misconception revolves around leaven. Leaven. Now, leaven in Scripture is generally taken as a symbol of evil or corruption. For example, at Passover, in the houses of Israelites, they would purge all leavening agents, and the bread which was eaten on that feast was to be unleavened. In the New Testament, Jesus compared the false teaching or sin of the Pharisees and Sadducees with leaven in Matthew 16. And then Jesus warned of the leaven of Herod. He was evil and immoral in Matthew 4. And then just talking about the Pharisees by themselves, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy, Luke 12. And then finally, Paul goes on and gives us a very clear example in 1 Corinthians 5. Do you remember there was a man living in sexual sin, and Paul says a little leaven goes throughout the whole lump. He warned the church to remove this man from your midst, like bad yeast, which ruins everything. Then we get to this parable. We've got all these examples of bad leaven. And now Jesus is talking about a good kind of leaven, good yeast. And so he's talking to law-keeping Jews in the ancient Near East. And then it's kind of like saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a forest fire to people in Fort McMurray. I don't think they'd be very impressed or saying, the kingdom of heaven is like COVID-19 and one of the people sitting next to you has it. You know, everybody'd be like, what are you talking about? We do not understand this. And I think Jesus is trying to use shock as a teaching model here. He's trying to really show them, change your minds. This, what you're thinking of is not right. He's trying to do a contrast to counter their misconception. Here is this gospel of the kingdom and the kingdom itself planted within a lump of dough, and it's good. And guess what? We are the lump. We are that lump of dough. Just like the nature of yeast is to grow and change whatever it contacts, so when we accept Christ, his grace is to grow in our hearts and change us from the inside out. See, as the gospel transforms each of our individual lives, then it also exerts a pervasive influence on the world at large. Now, the fourth misconception is probably the most deadly of all, and Stephen Budd talked about it a few weeks ago. This misconception is, well, it's not for me. I can be inoculated from the leaven, so to speak. You see, many are still looking for a Davidic or an external, visible manifestation of the kingdom and resist the inner workings. There's many people that want all the gifts and power of the Holy Spirit. They want signs and wonders and power, but their own hearts are hard to being changed to the grace of God. It's tragic. And Stephen was talking about this. He was quoting Gordon Fee. We have been invaded by the living God himself in the person of the Spirit, whose goal is to infect us, there's those words again, thoroughly with God's likeness. Paul's phrase for this infection is the fruit of the Spirit. The coming of the Spirit, along with the renewing of our minds, should give us a heavenly appetite for this kind of fruit. But it seems that many are, what, inoculated from the Spirit's infection and remain cold, little changed, and unaffected. Wow. You could say many remain like a cold, unrisen lump of dough, waiting for something to happen around them, signs, wonders, powers, gifts, but never looking within. It doesn't have to be so, but for many souls, it is so. And this is part of the great misconception and maybe the deadliest of all. See, this kingdom flourishing really comes when we work out what God has worked in. Now, let's look at the truth, conception. Kingdom flourishing is primarily internal. She hid, she kneaded into three measures of meal till it was all leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like good yeast working inside us. From Exodus in the Old Testament to the several examples I gave from the New Testament, the nature and effects of leaven are described, mostly in the negative sense. But remember, what we're speaking about now is good yeast, a positive sense, right? As the property of yeast is to change or conform to its nature, the dough where it's mixed into, so the property of the grace of Christ is to change the whole soul into his own likeness by the Spirit. That's why it's good leaven. It makes us more and more like the good one, Jesus Christ himself. And God intends that this principle should continue in the soul till all is leavened, till the whole lump becomes heavenly and holy instead of earthly and fallen. Both this parable that we're looking at and the mustard seed parable before it are prophetic. They're prophetic parables. And we're intended to show how from very small beginnings within our own souls, the gospel of Christ should spread and fill us and then all the nations of the world with true righteousness and holiness. Notice also that God is portrayed in the first, the parable of the mustard seed, as a man planting seeds. And in this one, God is portrayed as a woman kneading leaven into dough. There's a universality and a thoroughness here that Jesus is trying to show us. Like Paul, who said to the Thessalonians that he was both like a father, strengthening and encouraging, and like a nursing mother, caring gently for each of them. Jesus, like Paul, is showing that the kingdom is for all of us. No matter your background, no matter where you're coming from, the kingdom is for all of us. Now, next thing we see is that the whole lump is leavened. Now, what does this truth mean for us? I think the first thing is the kingdom of God may have small beginnings, but it will increase. Yeast is microscopic in size, and only a little is kneaded into the dough. Yet, given time, the yeast will spread throughout all the dough. In the same way, Jesus' domain started with teaching the 12 disciples. Then after the Passion, after Pentecost, the coming of the Spirit, a deeper and fuller manifestation that completely changed their characters to bold, loving, sold-out disciples. The kingdom gospel starts small, but makes progress. Second, the kingdom of God exerts its influence from within. We've been talking about this. It's not from without. Yeast makes dough rise from within. God first changes the heart of a person, and that internal change has external manifestations. The third thing is the effect of the kingdom of God will be comprehensive. Just as yeast works until the dough has completely risen and all of it, the transformation into the image of Christ will be fulfilled in us and then will spread. As you know, God says that I will carry on to completion this work that I've started until the day of Christ Jesus, Philippians 1. I think that's what he's talking about. And fourth, although the kingdom of God works invisibly, its effect becomes visible and evident to all. Yeast does its job slowly, right? My mom would often put a cloth over it and put it in a warm place, and it's this lump, and the next thing you know, the cloth is rising. It's just happening silently and secretly in there. But no one can deny its effect on the bread, right? And the same is true with the grace of God in our hearts. So we've talked about misconceptions of kingdom flourishing and true conceptions about kingdom flourishing, about us working out what God has worked in. But there's another point that we can't miss. And this is fulfillment. There's a result. Where's the beef, so to speak? Kingdom flourishing fulfilled till all was leavened, the scripture said. Now the rubber meets the road. We see fulfillment of these promises, true fulfillment and transformation. And there's three parts to it. There's God's part, our part, and then our need. Now God's part. We've been talking about the secret sauce, Jesus' representative, the Holy Spirit. When you became a believer, the Holy Spirit entered into you. And when you think about it, that alone is an amazing thing. God loves you and his Spirit lives within you. He is there to guide you, watch over you, transform you, correct you, and encourage you. And think of these verses. I'm just going to give you four verses. There's many more, but let me just give you four. Did you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? 1 Corinthians 6. Having believed in Jesus, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing your inheritance. Ephesians 1. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by what? By the Spirit of God, 1 Corinthians 6 again. And we reflect the Lord's glory. We are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit, 2 Corinthians 3. You see, we are like this lump of dough, and God has put his representative, the Holy Spirit, within us like yeast. The washing of regeneration begins with our being born again and continues by the renewing of the Holy Spirit to make us a new creation, a new person. We go from, as the old King James used to say, the old man to the new man, so to speak. And this process continues until we're formed to the image of Christ or until the Lord returns again. That's the Spirit's regenerating power. But the second thing is it produces fruit. As God transforms you, he wants to help you change your attitudes and emotions to help you grow in what the Bible calls the fruit of the Spirit. And you probably know this verse. The fruit of the Spirit is what? First of all, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Boy, that sure sounds like flourishing to me, doesn't it? If we're exhibiting those attitudes, that seems like flourishing. But here's the trick. God causes this fruit to grow. We don't just white-knuckle and say, okay, I'm going to be loving today. We cannot give what we have not received. We must receive the love of God in order to give the love of God, don't we? So he has to make it grow. He wants you to become fruitful and to flourish. And it's God's Holy Spirit, not us, who produces the fruit. The fruit grows as a result of the Spirit working within us, like leaven making the whole lump rise. This is what God has worked in. He has worked his Spirit into us. The second is our part. We have a role to play. Although God produces the fruit, he makes the dough rise with the yeast of the Spirit. There are things that we must do to help our fruit grow. We must work out what God has worked in. For example, surrender. We can loosen or break up the cold lump of our heart, allowing God's leaven to go deep within us. We can surrender to God's will for our lives. Second, the Bible. We can help work in the leaven by reading His Word every day. Community. We can warm the whole lump up by spending quality time with other believers and listening to sound teaching. Taking our thoughts captive. We can eliminate bad ingredients that would infect the lump and take these thoughts captive unto the Lord. We can eliminate bad habits, remove bad sections or unstirred parts of the dough. And we've all got habits that we need to get rid of. And then ultimately we can ask for filling. We can ask God to fill us with the leaven of His Spirit even more so that we can be filled with the Spirit, like Ephesians 5 talks about. And then Luke 11:13 says, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those children who ask Him? In all these ways, we work out what God has worked in and keep the dough warm so the yeast of the Spirit can be effective. We work out what God has worked in. We are transformed and flourish by the Spirit of God. This is how we can be well-risen dough, not a flop. So we've seen God's part and our part, but then there's something else. We have a need. Some of you say, Kari, I'm not sure. You don't know my circumstances, my upbringing. I feel self-condemned. I've been condemned all my life. That's true. I may not know all of your circumstances, but I do know that Christ lives in you by the power of the Spirit, and He has worked in every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies. So we need two things for ourselves. To appropriate this kingdom flourishing, we need knowledge and faith in Jesus. Knowledge and faith in Jesus. It's all over the scriptures, but let me just take one section of four or five scriptures in 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 to 7. Let me give you some of the words in those few verses. Here's some of the words Peter uses of us, you and I. Grace, peace, abundance, mercy, new birth, living hope, inheritance that never perishes, spoils, or fades, shielded by God's power. Coming of salvation, and then at the end, even in griefs and trials. Despite the circumstances, God wants us to have all of this. This is the life He wants for you. Abundant, rich, full, hopeful, even in trials. So now you know. There it is. There's the first one. The second one is faith in Jesus. To believe who Jesus is and what He has promised to do for you. Now, don't miss this part. We must appropriate these truths by faith. The Jesus who is so good, so great, who has given everything for you. He loved you and gave Himself for you, Galatians 2:20. Now, He gives Himself to you. Before, He gave Himself for you. Now, He gives Himself to us through the Spirit. Jesus is the lover of your soul. He is your King, yes, but also your friend. He is your righteous elder brother. He is your spouse. We are the bride of Christ. He comes to live within you by the power of the Spirit. And this is the spiritual impartation of Himself into our hearts. That's why I was reading 2 Corinthians 3:18. We are being transformed into His glorious image by the Holy Spirit. By faith, we can cry out to Him for more. We can receive this new life He has given us in love. We receive it by faith. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith, says 1 John 5. So this flourishing comes when we work out what He has worked in. So this message has been about the kingdom of heaven and parables and flourishing, yes. In the past, some of you have felt like a flop. Like the furthest thing from flourishing, self-condemnation, maybe even self-hatred has ruled. But we also saw that the kingdom of heaven actually lives within you. The good yeast of the Holy Spirit. You are a child of God Himself. It's like this hidden treasure that produces hidden transformation within us and then in those around us who are infected by the Spirit's transforming effects. We saw how to overcome misconceptions. We saw the true conceptions of fulfillment and flourishing. But we have a key role to play. Knowledge and faith in Jesus are key. Are you going to continue in your self-condemnation? You have a choice every day, don't we? We have a choice every day. Or will you cooperate with Jesus and yield yourself to the leading and transforming work of his Spirit today? If you do, you will become a well-risen, flourishing person in his heavenly kingdom. I just pray that you'll trust Jesus today and flourish in the Spirit. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Kyrie, very much. My kids are growing. They would probably tell you that they've grown. but I'll always be their father. And there's something that I thoroughly enjoyed, and I still enjoy, and it's when I come home. From not having seen them for a while, and to hear this phrase or this word, Daddy! Isn't that fantastic? Isn't that a lovely, wonderful thing? Well, Scripture tells us that we can call out to our Heavenly Father and call out, Father, Dad, Papa, Daddy. You know, He longs for you to run to Him and to find closeness and intimacy with Him. Someone had shared one of those, like a long time ago, one of those advice columns about what to expect when the dad comes home from work. And, oh, they're so hilarious. They're so funny. And one of them said, you know, so make sure that you wash your children's faces and have them all presentable. Maybe change, put them into clean clothes. And it's like, oh, my. What a wonderful thing that we have a Heavenly Father who is okay that when we cry out to Him, Daddy, that we are wearing our day and it's all over our face. He knows what we've been doing. He knows where we are. Come to Him and find that your soul will rise and you will actually come into flame and you will be a soul on fire. Come to Him and find His love and experience His presence. Let's close. Let's stand as we sing together. Thank you online, those who have joined with us. We're going to close with the song simply entitled Soul on Fire.
Again.
Look.
Well, Steve and Heather, worship team, thank you very much for leading us into the presence of the Lord this morning. Tech team, thank you for putting the tinfoil on the aerial for us today. We appreciate that. And the admin team doing all the work back in the office, thank you again. Now for each of you. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Go with God this morning.